Hi, I'm Dr. Gans Ferenc. I'm a registered psychologist and I work at the Ferenc Group. I love my iPhone. So I use my iPhone all the time. I use it way more than my computer. I use it for scheduling. I use it for communication. I look stuff up. I check my website on it, do banking. So really the iPhone is probably my go-to place for technology right now. What I've been using a lot is the voice memo because I have been doing a lot of recordings for articles that I want to put together or different things like that. And so what I actually do is I've recorded myself putting together thoughts that I want to remember, things that I need to feed into my subconscious, and then I play that early morning when I'm relaxing and I kind of hear my own voice telling me all the good stuff I need to do for the day, and it keeps me going. So it's a really good tool. We have an automated home system as well. So again, the iPhone, I use that to make sure the thermostat's set properly, turn on and off the alarm, making sure that, you know, if there's somebody comes to the door, we're not there, I can actually see them and talk to them. And it's quite convenient because then if we need a delivery or if somebody needs like a repair person or somebody needs to get into the house, I can let them in. So I really love that feature. In my professional life, really I use a lot of, mostly text is quite convenient for me because when people need to get a hold of me, clients or people I need to do speaking for or media for, the easiest, quickest way is for them to text me, can respond really quickly if I need to. So I've been using text for clients for about the last 2 years and it's quite convenient. They like it. I like it. Well, actually, it might not be missing, but one of the things that's coming up right now, there are a lot of apps on the market that are actually geared, you know, we have the ones for, you know, your physical health, you can track your health, you can track your eating. There are a lot of psychological apps that are coming on the market now too, which are, some of them are quite good. I mean, there are meditation apps, there are things to help you manage your anxiety or, you know, different scales to figure out what your mood is like. And I think some of those things can be really helpful, especially for folks that are plugged in all the time. Now they don't take the place of, you know, an actual psychologist or speaking to somebody, but they're a nice tool to help you just gain more self-awareness and kind of track how you're doing from day to day and even within the day. And you know, a lot of them have like suggestions for how to stay on track, whether it's to manage your mood or manage your sleep or whatever it might be. So I really do encourage my clients to look at some of those. And one of the things I tell my clients to do is actually, again, using the iPhone, just using the timer. They can time out like 3 hours, and every 3 hours, if they just set their timer and they take a break, like a 5 minute break every 3 hours. And that's a great use of the technology because a lot of times we forget. Sometimes if people are stressed out enough, they forget to eat or go to the bathroom, right? So the timer really comes in handy when you have that. Once in a while I use slides, and I have used traditional PowerPoint with that. But that would actually be something that I would love to use more of is PowerPoint or some sort of platform that would give me some more graphics that's easy to use and quick to use and quick to learn. Yeah, when I do the presentations, it's talking, it's quite interactive, and usually I just use like either a whiteboard or a flip chart to write stuff on. It's really quick and easy. Honestly, one of the biggest barrier for me is time. And so time to learn the new system and to make sure I get it right. So being able to take the time to figure out what I need to do, then how to apply it in the most efficient and effective way. Honestly, if I had a tutor, that would be awesome. Or if I hired a young assistant that knows exactly what he or she is doing, that would probably work too. The blue light situation is a real thing. It really does change the hormone profile in your brain and it can actually wake you up. So you really want to not have that when you're going to sleep. So the screens that have the blue light, I know iPhone has night shift now, so everything goes towards yellow. But there are a few issues. One is the content you're watching before you go to bed. That's important because that can be quite activating and disturb your sleep. Then there's the blue light, right? If it's tinted towards the blue, it does actually reduce the amount of melatonin your brain produces, so you're not sleeping as well. But then there's also, you know, if you're watching TV or playing video games, there's a strobe effect, right? And that can also disturb your sleep too. So you really want to be mindful of the screens. They recommend that you finish all screens and start to dim the lights about an hour before you go to bed, and then sleep in a cool, dark room. And I really, really, really recommend people turn off their phones at night or put them on Do Not Disturb, particularly for kids, because a lot of the kids are sleeping with their phones, they're up and down all night, or even if they're not awake, they're being disturbed by the buzzing or the notifications or whatever that happens. So I think the big thing is we have to use technology as a tool and not be slaves to it. And unfortunately, I think because technology is moving so fast, there's stuff available to us, but we haven't figured out sort of the best ways to use them in keeping with our culture and our health and our relationships just yet. So one of the things I've noticed is that because technology is so available and is so useful in lots of ways, and to some extent somewhat addictive, there have been people who have gotten in trouble with technology, like in, you know, technological addictions or social media addiction, or, you know, like driving while texting, for example. The rule of thumb that I usually teach people in my presentations is pretend, like some of the young people might not know what this is, but a newspaper, right? Okay, so pretend your technology is a newspaper. Anything that seems like it doesn't make sense to do with a newspaper, don't do it with your phone or your tablet. If it wouldn't make sense for you to sit across from a date and pull out a newspaper and read it, don't do that with your phone when you're on a date. If you're walking across the street, probably not a good idea to have your face in the paper. Don't be on your phone when you're crossing the street. Don't, you know, be looking after your baby and have a newspaper up like that instead of interacting with him or her. So it's a good rule of thumb. Pretend it's a newspaper and use it that way. Because if not, you get yourself in trouble, either in relationships and or in traffic.